Good morning, good afternoon, or good evening. Doesn't matter what time of day or night it is, I'm still just as equally glad and just as grateful that you've chosen to stop by my little channel. If you're seeing one of my videos for the first time, my name is Reverend Paul J. Bern. I'm the online pastor of the little online church that's not a church called the Social Gospel Worship and Learning Center of Atlanta, Georgia. This is the church without any brick and mortar, without any religion. We don't teach one religion over another. We don't teach religion at all. All we teach about here is Jesus Christ, crucified, died, and resurrected. That's the starting point for each one of these messages. And right now, I am getting ready to give you another. This one is going to be part 4 of Acts chapter 13, the close after chapter 13, which is a long chapter. I had to break it up into 4 parts for the sake of brevity, if nothing else, to keep the videos from running on. So, this week's title is The Risen Spirit of the Lord Works Like a Magnet for God's People. This is going to be taken from Acts chapter 13, verses 42 through 52. Before I start, don't forget to check out my author page, if you haven't already done so. I'm on Amazon at amazon.com/author/Rev Paul J. Bern. That's R-E-V-P-A-U-L-J-B-E-R-N. All lowercase. You are about to hear a brief excerpt from my Christian nonfiction book, The Social Gospel Teaching Series, Volume 2, The Acts of the Apostles, by yours truly. This material is copyrighted in 2022 by Reverend Paul J. Bern. That's me. All rights are reserved. Okay. To begin with, when we left off last week at verse 41 of Acts chapter 13, the Apostle Paul was concluding his first sermon as a new convert as he addressed the synagogue in Pisidian Antioch. Now, Pisidian Antioch, or the ruins thereof, is located about a kilometer north of the modern-day town of Yalvac. That's Y-A-L-V-A-C, if you want to look that up, in the province of Isparta, in southern Turkey. He finished up the greater portion of that Sabbath morning by quoting from the prophet Habakkuk from chapter 1 and verse 5 in the Old Testament, and I quote, "Look, you scoffers, wonder and perish. For I am going to do something in your days that you would never believe, even if someone told you." Close quote. Paul the Apostle was referring to those present who rejected his message, and there were many, all of whom were Jews, and many of whom were quite vocal about being one. Their vocal and vehement opposition to Paul's message of salvation as taught by Christ will come to a climax here as we finish up together my final installment of Acts chapter 13. So, let's take up where we last left off, beginning at verse 42, and this is going to go up to 47 and stop there. Beginning at verse 42, and I quote, as Paul and Barnabas were leaving the synagogue, the people invited them to speak further about these things on the next Sabbath. When the congregation was dismissed, many of the Jews and devout converts to Judaism followed Paul and Barnabas, who talked with them and urged them to continue in the grace of God. On the next Sabbath, almost the whole city gathered to hear the word of the Lord. When the Jews saw the crowds, they were filled with jealousy. They began to contradict what Paul was saying and heaped abuse upon him. Continuing at verse 46, it reads, and then Paul and Barnabas answered them boldly. We had to speak the word of God to you first, meaning you Jews. Since you reject it and do not consider yourself worthy of eternal life, we now turn to the Gentiles. For this is what the Lord has commanded us. I have made you a light for the Gentiles, that you may bring salvation to the ends of the earth. Closed quote. Now, to take off from this, the first place I want to stop is in the subheading is watch out for wrong teachings in modern churches. Not all modern churches are what they're cranked up to be. That's why people prefer this. Virtual church, online church, over and above the physical church, because it's the churches, they've just lost their spirituality. It's like they lost their souls and can't find where they put them. Sad. And so, the crowd that they received the word from the Lord through Paul's message that had an authentic spiritual power, a formidable message that was beyond description. The church still has preachers and teachers of the word who discharge their duties with power and anointing, but we continue to need a lot more of them. I myself am working on turning into such a person, myself. So what we don't need, though, are more preachers of the prosperity gospel or the pre-tribulation rapture, where the entire church, allegedly, gets a free pass, never having to endure any persecution in the end times in which we find ourselves today. We're just in the beginning phases of it, actually. These are false teachings that must be avoided. If you enter a church, sit through the service, at the end of the service, if you come to the conclusion that the church is more about Jesus wanting to get us all rich than about real authentic faith, get out of there. Don't go back. Find a better. If you can't find one, you know where you can come back to, right here to this little channel. Continuing then. What Paul and Barnabas achieved through the Spirit of the risen Lord. The people in that synagogue that morning weren't as stupid and naive as some Christians are today. They knew the real thing when they saw it. And they knew real truth when they heard it. Divine truth. That is exactly why Paul and Barnabas were invited to return the following Sabbath. That's why the people wanted so much to hear them again. Once a preacher or teacher gets his or her students or audience focused on the things of God, instead of that of this world. The scope and depth of their entire field of vision completely changes focus, which changes the listeners forever. That's precisely what Paul and Barnabas accomplished that morning. That's exactly what they did. They hit it out of the ballpark, the ball return from baseball. But anyway, moving right along here. The risen spirit, then, works like a magnet for every person in the whole town, just like it did in Pisidian Antioch. Going back and quoting verses 44 and 45, on the next Sabbath, almost the whole city gathered to hear the word of the Lord. And when the Jews saw the crowds, they were filled with jealousy. They began to contradict what Paul was saying and heaped abuse upon him. Close quote. It seems supernatural now to us that almost the entire city, and I quote, showed up the following Sabbath for morning services. Considering there was no phone, internet, or email, Paul and Barnabas relied solely on word of mouth. And it really paid off big, just like when Jesus walked the earth his Father created. The teachings of and about Christ did, however, and still do, unfortunately, offend a few people. When the Jews who were in charge of the synagogue there back then heard Paul's words, they were filled with jealousy and rage. As I have written previously, the Jews of that time, plus many more since, see themselves as exclusive unto themselves, having little or nothing to do with non-Jews. The very thought of equality between Jew and Gentile offended some of them, especially those in positions of leadership. But they were offended most of all with the teaching of Christ as Messiah. That's kind of hard to get offended about Jesus. That's what I say. Christianity, then, although not everyone agrees with it, still, Christianity is meant for everybody. It's just a question of who will embrace it and who won't. And I'm quoting again from the above scripture. Then Paul and Barnabas answered them boldly, "We had to speak the word of the Lord to you first, and since you reject it and do not consider yourselves worthy of eternal life, we now turn to the Gentiles." The reason, close quote by the way, the reason Paul and Barnabas spoke the word of God to the Jews first, it's because they were themselves Jewish, as was Christ the Lord. The fact that they were in such a synagogue bore heavily in this case too, but there are also many Gentiles present, such as Greeks, secular and Christian Arabs, and Turkish individuals as well. But the way the Bible is translated right here doesn't really convey how animated the discussion surrounding Paul's Sabbath message actually was, because it says that Paul and Barnabas answered them boldly. That means they pulled no punches. Paul and Barnabas then quote from the book of Isaiah. That's where some of this stuff was taken from that was in the original quote. And let me just quote this to you. At first, though, in 21st century terms, this could be written as Paul and Barnabas took all the rejection, the snobbery, and the contempt heaped upon them and threw it all back in their faces. The accusatory manner in which the insults were delivered to them was thrown back in the faces of all the Jews who refused to believe their message and who were verbally abusive to them. Interestingly enough, there was not a single Gentile in the audience who rejected Paul's and Barnabas' message. They then quote scripture to back themselves up. And I quote them, "For this is what the Lord has commanded us. I have made you a light for the Gentiles, that you may bring salvation to the ends of the earth." So that originally came from Isaiah chapter 49 and verse 6, if you'd like to look that up. As you're finishing up there, next subtitle is Christ Magnified. Just two words, Christ Magnified, in the original Greek text, which was written about AD 100 or so, the year 100, known today by theologians as the Septuagint. That's the Septuagint. What it's called. The U in that previous verse is in the singular, indicating that the message is for each individual reader. Now, this is significant because it lines up with the words of Christ, and I quote, starting at verse 18, "Then Jesus came to them and said, all authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Therefore go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you. And surely I am with you always to the very end of the age." Now, those three verses were taken from Matthew chapter 28, verses 18 through 20. And now, bearing that stuff in mind, let's conclude this week's study, starting at verse 48. Just very briefly here, when the Gentiles heard this, they were glad and honored the word of the Lord. And all who were appointed for eternal life believed. The word of the Lord spread through the whole region. But the Jewish leaders incited the God-fearing women of high standing and the leading men of the city. They stirred up persecution against Paul and Barnabas and expelled them from their region. And so they shook the dust off their feet as a warning to them, and went to Iconium, another city just a little further down the road. And the disciples were filled with joy and with the Holy Spirit. Now understand, these guys just got put out of the whole region. Like, imagine yourself in whatever state you live in, having that state put you out of the state forever. From now on, you got to go, live in the Bahamas or something. They say the weather's nice there. Anyway, Christ Magnified. And now let's conclude this week's study at verse 48. When the Gentiles heard this, they were glad and honored the word of the Lord, and all who were appointed for eternal life believed. The word of the Lord spread through the whole region. But the Jewish leaders incited the God-fearing women of high standing and the leading men of the city. They stirred up persecution against Paul and Barnabas and expelled them from their region. And so they shook the dust off their feet as a warning to them and went to Iconium. As I said, the disciples were filled with joy and with the Holy Spirit because they got thrown out. And I think that's just utterly amazing. It's a sign of true strength. And moving right along here, I guess, next subheading, which is part of the whole message here, is our souls are immortal, but our bodies are not. And I quote from that previous scripture just read above, all who were appointed for eternal life believed. The word of the Lord spread throughout the whole region. Notice it says all who were or are appointed. And that means appointed by God from long before any of us were born. It is a reference to the prophecies from the Old and New Testaments concerning eternal life. For example, take a look at the book of Psalms, Psalm 119 and verse 89. From Isaiah chapter 26 and verse 4. Matthew chapter 19 and verse 16. Or 1 John chapter 5 verse 13, among others. If you want to see some commentary about eternal life, delivered straight from the original 12 apostles. Straight from them. Eternal life, you know, it's a black and white issue, everybody. There is no gray area here. It's not that some have it while others don't. Everyone has a soul, or a spirit, if you like, that lives on after our bodies wear out and die. It's where our souls will spend eternity. That is what makes all the difference. Some will spend eternity with Jesus and all the saints, which is his bride, the greater church. Others will spend theirs in hell for refusing to believe in God, or at least in his son Jesus, and for adamantly refusing to obey the teachings and commands of Jesus Christ. The two foremost commands he has already given us, that we should love our God, our Creator, with all our heart, mind, soul, and strength, and to love our neighbors as ourselves. Those are the very words of Christ right there, meaning those who are lovers of everything else but God and each other will burn. Sorry if that sounds unduly harsh, but I don't get up here and tell lies, pretty lies. I don't sugarcoat my message. My message is raw truth, raw and undiluted. Moving right along here. It says in the text there, and I quote, they stirred up persecution against Paul and Barnabas and expelled them from their region, and so they shook the dust off their feet as a warning to them. By now you all must realize that it was only by their reliance on the Holy Spirit to guide them, plus some very sharp wits, that enabled Paul and Barnabas to survive all the attacks and persecutions that they were subject to. Paul and Barnabas weren't just thrown out of a synagogue or out of the city of Antioch. They were expelled from the entire region, of Sparta, where they were located there. The work of the apostles, though, and other disciples, is magnified by the Lord. But they rejoice because of it, for they had the honor of being persecuted for their belief in Christ as their Lord and Savior. The disciples were filled with joy and filled with the Holy Spirit. Close quote. But this was about far more than just their own beliefs. This was about fulfilling their mission to tell as many people about the gospel as they could. Whether their message, the message of Christ, was well received by the listeners was not left up to them, but rather to the Holy Spirit. Their mission, and that of the 12, and all the others with them by this point, was fulfilled once the message was delivered, the healing had been distributed, and prayers offered. At that point, it was time to move on to the next town. That would be an interesting life in his service, don't you think? The service of Christ? Traveling around from town to town, depending on whether the weather, to be able to preach at outdoor meetings when a synagogue wasn't available. Never having a PA system. Never knowing what kind of reception you were going to get. This was the life of an apostle in the post-ascension world. In next week's lesson, as we move on to chapter 14, we will see how all this continues to play out as the early church continues to rapidly grow. Until then. Now, since you like this little channel, by listening to it and viewing it all the way to the end, why don't you come and join me by giving the channel a like and a share, and especially a subscribe, so that you can, every time I make a new video, it'll get dropped right into your inbox. No more searching. Very convenient. There also will be access to 18 million other writers and bloggers and video producers like myself. All of us are part of the new economy, that's for sure. But you can help me stay afloat too by purchasing a book or a t-shirt. Visit the Social Gospel Worship and Learning Center on Google My Business. Just go to Google My Business and type the Social Gospel Worship and Learning Center into the search, and it'll pop right up. You can see the shirts, see the books. My books are also on Facebook at facebook.com/ Reverend Paul Bern. You'll find him there. So there are two places. Anyway, I guess that's all for now. I've said everything I need to say for this point. I want to thank you all for the privilege of your time. You are all very, very much appreciated. And still, until next time, everybody be blessed. In Jesus' mighty name.